please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Well, on to the big event of the day that we are tracking. The six-member Monetary Policy Committee, headed by RBI Governor Urjit Patel, is meeting for the first time in FY19. Now, the two-day meeting comes at a time when pressure has been mounting on the Monetary Policy Panel to cut interest rates in the wake of declining retail inflation and the need to fuel growth momentum. Now, is the panel expected to yield to these demands? And what are the other big issues on its agenda? Lata Venkatesh joins us now with the highlights from the CNBC TV18 poll. Lata, what are the expectations and run us through the agenda?
Well, there has been so much of a seesaw in bond markets in the last 8 to 12 weeks that most participants expect that the policy will not do anything. An equilibrium is there in the market, and therefore the poll says that 100% of the respondents expect no action. But will there be action later on in the year? There the street is divided, with about 40% believing that there could be one rate hike at least in the remaining part of the year. And that is what people will look for in terms of cues. One of the cues will come from what is the RBI's growth trajectory likely to be. It's the first policy of the year and it's accompanied by a monetary policy report. So people will look for the forecast. Will growth forecasts be lowered? The current forecast for FY19, the last forecast available from RBI, was 7.2%, already modest. So will RBI lower that because of, you know, the problems in the banking space, the NPAs that have to be provided for? Any mention of that will mean it's a dovish policy. Alternatively, will inflation forecast be increased or decreased? At the moment, the inflation forecast stands at 5.1 to 5.6 for the first half and 4.5 to 4.6 in the second half. There could be pressures to increase it because crude, after all, has increased compared to what it was when the previous forecasts were arrived. If the crude is assumed to be, previously it was assumed to be $55. If the assumption is, say, $65, then accordingly this will have to be revised up. MSP is another issue, another reason why it could be revised up. Any hint of upward risk to our trajectory could be something which the markets will see as hawkish. So ultimately, that's what market participants will watch out for. The tone, will it be more hawkish than previous policies? As you can see, most people believe it will be neutral, exactly as it was previously. No action and a neutral policy, that will be something the markets actually will be happy with, because enough of turbulence is there in the global seas and in the bond markets itself in the past couple of months. But there will be outside the policy things that people will watch out for, whether the limits of foreign buying in Indian bonds is raised. That's widely expected and could keep bonds on the front foot. And of course, you must expect a lot of chatter on NPAs, public sector bank frauds and private sector bank, if you can call it, sharp practices. A lot of questions will be on perhaps non-monetary policy issues.
All right, so 7 hours to go. A lot of focus will be on the non-monetary policy issues. Status quo expected. We will know in 7 hours. And stay tuned to CNBC TV18 for the monetary policy. Moving on then, the Union Cabinet has taken some crucial decisions, and the topmost among them is the right-sizing of the Competition Commission. The M&A watchdog currently has one chairperson and six members. The Cabinet has decided to trim this to down to one chairperson and three members. That's a strength of four people versus seven people earlier. The government claims that this move is in pursuance of its minimum government, maximum governance objective. We caught up with the competition lawyers and senior advocates who worry that this move may further slow down the decision-making process at the CCI.
Principally, I agree that if they are pruning it to a body of four, this may delay certain decision-making within the CCI, because there are certain merger approvals, which is one side of the function of CCI, and the second side is where the disputes are to be looked into. Mm. So if they do not have adequate members to look into the matters on either side, on the merger side or the dispute side, then this may delay the process.
This was in the offing for a very long time.
Okay.
And the murmurs were that people having retired, members were about to retire, there would not be a reappointment because the government was already contemplating this. The fact that they have tried to reduce it from a seven-member to a four-member would probably lead to efficiencies. It is not as if that the seven-member team made a very great impact, as long as there was a balance. The only thing is that you need to have a right balance of people. So even a four-member committee or a four-member commission can probably do a good job, depending on the constituents of that commission.
I think it's a really surprising decision. I mean, the CCI is something which has to have expertise in multi divisions. By getting it down from seven to four, how are you going to bring about more efficiency into the system? In fact, if anything, they should have said you could have different benches so that work would get expedited. Mm. I mean, they're already overloaded with work. Totally shocking. It just doesn't make any sense.
Okay, on that note, let's slip into a quick break. Up next, we learn that the government may look at an ordinance to tweak IBC. Details on that when we return.
Now, the 14-member insolvency law committee set up by the government to undertake a comprehensive review of the insolvency and bankruptcy code, the IBC as we know it, has proposed some seminal changes to the law. If implemented, these changes could actually alter the course of resolutions currently under NCLT. So, is the government planning to adopt all of these recommendations? Well, Sapna Das filed this report earlier, and there is where you have all your answers.
We are given to understand that most of the recommendations made by the Insolvency and the Law Committee in terms of further changes to IBC may actually go through the amendment process. Most of them will be accepted. Like, for instance, the fact that 90% voting by COC will allow the parties for an out-of-court settlement. However, there's a strong caveat here, and this is something that needs to be highlighted, that this can only be done till the time the bids are not submitted. The date of reckoning is the bid submission. Once the bid submission happens, there can be no further leeway. So that is one. There are lots of other important ones that they've spoken about. For example, that most of the changes will be prospective in nature. That's what we're given to understand. But, however, the same condition may apply here, that wherever the bids have not been submitted, probably some tweaks may be allowed, but once the bid submission is complete so whatever new rules will come into force, once the bids are complete, will not apply. But as long as the bids have not been submitted, it is quite possible that the tweaks may be allowed. So that's one big thing that may go through. We are also given to understand that it will be the ordinance route that the government will adopt, probably because they can't wait till the monsoon session for these changes to come about. And there could also be the possibility of going beyond the recommendations of the Insolvency and Law Committee, something more that the government may have in mind. Last but not the least, on the MSME sector particularly, we are given to understand the cabinet nod may not be required because there's already an enabling dispensation under the Companies Act, so that may happen through a notification.
Okay, thank you, Sapna, for bringing us that update. But we also caught up with members of the IBC review panel, Shardul Shroff and Rashesh Shah. Hear out what they had to say about the key recommendations made by the panel.
Before any resolution and the process and the response is really received, if the creditors, like they used to do in the JLR or in the JLM, come about with a position where they can settle with the corporate debtor, and they have settled with the corporate debtor, then with 90% of the approval of the committee of creditors, they can cause a settlement based upon bilateral processes rather than a resolution plan and come to a solution.
Are we also giving a backdoor entry to the promoters to get back their company in this process by relaxing 29A in these recommendations?
So it's a distinct departure from 29AC, which is applicable to larger enterprises where the promoter is obligated to pay off the overdue amounts, costs, charges and interest up to the date of filing of the resolution plan. So this is the distinction which has been in a sort of a liberal treatment given to the MSME, provided you are not a willful default. The other question which was raised was that wherever there is a pure financial player, like for example a distressed asset fund or an asset reconstruction company or private equity which is looking at distressed assets, then these kind of financial players should be excluded from the principles of Section 29A for the reason that it is their main object to try and get these kind of distressed assets into their fold and turn them around.
We are currently seeing in a couple of other cases where there is an even better offer outside of the IBC process and where somebody does not want to be in IBC, but wants to do a restructuring or acquisition or a merger of that company outside of IBC. So we said if the 90% of the creditors agree, then there should be a provision to withdraw the case from an IBC, because currently anybody can take a case to IBC, but once it goes into IBC, there is no process to withdraw it.
Right, and the lenders of Benani Cement met yesterday to consider an out-of-court settlement offer for the company. A meeting of the lenders was convened after the NCLAT, the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, ruled that lenders and Benani Industries may settle the insolvency matter outside the court if they so wished. No decision was reached at the meet last night. Nisha Podar is here with the exclusive details on the Benani Industries offer.
So we have an exclusive access to the blueprint of the offer that Benani Industries has made to the lenders, which is being deliberated upon. Now, this particular offer clearly states that 7,229 crore rupees is the total sum which has been offered by Benani Industries to the lenders. Now, it's under various heads, and there are even CIRP costs, workmen wages, but the largest chunk really coming in to the secured as well as the unsecured financial credit. So let me take you through that, because most of the listed banks as well as ARCs fall under that particular category, and how much they can really recover if this plan and the settlement were to happen. Now, also remember that Benani Industries, along with this particular offer, has also given deadlines of settlement within 30 days, settlement within 3 days to entice a speedier settlement by the lenders. Now, financial creditors under the secured category, total amount in full payment would be about 4,049 crore rupees, out of which the biggest beneficiary will be Edelweiss ARC, which has a total amount of 2,783 crore rupees. Apart from that, remember some of the lenders, IDBI Limited with 336 crore rupees, larger being Bank of Baroda with 428 crore rupees. The lender which had in the first place dragged Benani Cement to the NCLT, Canara Bank, 370 crore rupees, Bank of India as well as SBI as well. Under the unsecured financial creditors, the total amount is close to about 2,427 crore rupees, and in that IDBI Bank is going to be the biggest beneficiary with over 1,500 crore rupees that could be recovered through this particular settlement. Apart from that, some of the aggrieved parties like Exim Bank with 620 crore rupees, and also SBI Hong Kong, which had raised a concern on the payment of Dalmia Bharat and them winning the bid, that is also likely to gain in this particular one in full. And Bank of Baroda under unsecured financial creditor also stands to gain about 171 crore rupees. Also, there has been an offer to pay the trade creditors to the tune of 443 crore rupees. So under various heads, all these amounts are given, and this is the final offer which the lenders have to deliberate upon.
Okay, thank you, Nisha, for getting us all those exclusive details. Let's see what comes out of that particular developing story, but it's time now for a quick break. Okay, on to the top story that we are tracking today. The six-member Monetary Policy Committee, headed by RBI Governor Urjit Patel, will give its monetary policy decision for the first time in financial year 19. Remember, the industry has been pitching for a rate cut in the hope that a cut in interest rates would provide a fillip to the economy. But is there a rate cut on the horizon? Here's what CNBC TV18 Citizens Monetary Policy Committee had to say on their expectations on the monetary policy and the probable tone of the RBI.
Gentlemen and lady, it's time to vote. Please pick up your voting boards. And the first question to you is, what should the action be? Should it be a pause or hold, if you please? Should it be a hike? Should it be a cut? Let me start with Soumyo. Soumyo, what would you vote?
Okay, there's a pause in this policy.
All right. Well, let me come to Saminan. Pause as well. Okay. Sajid. Sajid says pause as well. It's a hold. Let me go to the lady before I come to the chairman. Sonal. All right. Pause.
Pause.
Yes. Chairman, sir. Hold. All right. The committee is unanimous that no action. But can the MPC do something with its tone, with the tone of the statement? Again, let me start with Soumyo. What would you expect the tone will be? Neutral, dovish?
I expect to be neutral to a cautious statement.
Okay, so more on the hawkish side, cautious. I would take it that way. Samiran, just neutral. You're not giving it any adjective. Hawkish or dovish. All right. As neutral as neutral can get. your vote, your expectation?
It's neutral to cautious.
Neutral to cautious. So, okay, not expecting too much dovishness. Sonal?
Cautious.
I should expect that from you. That was your argument as well. Chairman, sir, would you expect that the MPC should or could sound a little dovish? Okay, cautious on growth. That's important, sir. So the chairman chooses to differ when it comes to the tone. He wants it to be cautious on growth and take that on board. But the four other members expect it to be either neutral or maybe slightly cautious.
Well, let's shift focus to the world of commodities, and Manisha Gupta now joins us to get us an update from what's happening in that world. Manisha, good morning. Over to you.
Well, thank you so much for that. There's just so much happening in the global market, starting right with the China and U.S. spat. And then, of course, you saw the equity markets rebound, and that has given some strength to the U.S. dollar and other asset classes, including commodities as well, where you saw the crude oil prices also taking some support. And apart from that, there has been a draw or a decline in the U.S. inventories, which has been supportive. That took the prices on the higher side. But then markets are waiting for the U.S. non-farm payroll data tomorrow. Much of the direction would come in from that. In sense of crude oil prices, it also has to do with the statements coming in from Saudi Arabia and Iran. The concerns there have just about continued. So I think we are going to close this week on a very, very range-bound trend. We haven't been able to take 70 on the higher side. We did see a low of 66.5 yesterday for Brent. It's holding around 68 right now. So really a pivot point is how the Brent crude prices are trading in the Asian markets right now. The gold and silver prices in the meanwhile, well, yesterday it was a safe haven buying. You saw nearly a percentage point of gain in the New York session. That hasn't been able to hold on. You have seen a decline in the safe havens. So not just the gold, silver, platinum, etc., but the Swiss franc and the Japanese yen have also declined. And some bit of a risk appetite seems to be back in Asia.
All right, Manisha, some bit of risk appetite back in Asia. In fact, something is like that can be reflected in the SGX Nifty as well, closer to that 10,300 mark, extending its gains closer to the high point of today's trading session. As far as the SGX Nifty is concerned, it will be very interesting to see how we open and how we sustain that, given the fact that yesterday, despite the cut in the markets, we saw institutional flows coming in positive from the FIIs. They bought about 335 crores in cash markets, the first purchase in FY19. The domestic institutional investors, however, sold about 153 crores. But during the intraday decline, we saw the Nifty futures premium correct from 52 points a couple of days ago down to 18 points, indicating that, yes, there was a lot of selling at the top by the FIIs. Despite being just 18% long yesterday, too, the FIIs sold about 1,100 crore worth in index futures, and the short exposure now is at 82%. They bought one call for one put, so playing for both sides as far as the market is concerned. But what was interesting is that they wrote two calls per put, indicating that maybe there could be some upside pressure. Talking about the upside pressure, a lot of calls were written at the 10,200 level, 10,300, 10,400, as well as 10,500. So from 10,200 to 10,500, we've seen a cumulative selling of close to around 30, 40 lakh calls, a case for short covering if the first hour gap up is sustained. Watch out for the Nifty Bank. Spot is at 24,130. Just 100 points below that is the maximum open interest on the put side. That's one level I'll be watching out for.
Okay, so interesting setup as far as the derivative space is concerned. Thank you, Mangalam, for that. But with that, it is a wrap on Power Breakfast from the team and myself. Thank you so much for watching. Bazaar Morning Call comes up next.
Welcome back. Before we start Bazaar, we just have some breaking news for you. I just spoke with Mr. Deepak Kochar, husband of Chanda Kochar and CEO and MD of ICICI Bank. Deepak Kochar clarified several things that people have been asking about the transaction. The first thing he said is that Venugopal Dhoot was not the owner of Supreme Energy when Supreme Energy invested in 64 crore debentures of New Power. Venugopal Dhoot had resigned on Jan 15 and the investment was made in March. So Dhoot was not the owner of Supreme Energy when that company invested 64 crores in the convertible debentures. I did ask him then who invested, where did the money come from? He said, I anyway have to speak to the investigative agencies and it will be revealed to them. But the second leg of the point, since that 64 crores has been called a gift, Mr. Dhoot, Mr. Kochar clarified that it was not a gift. When he bought Supreme Energy in his trust Pinnacle, which he manages, he also bought the liability of 64 crores. So when it gets redeemed, he will pay it up. So the 64 crores is not a gift. So two specific things, Dhoot was not the owner when Supreme Energy invested, and 64 crores is not a gift, it's a liability. So Supreme Energy is liable to pay that money, and the current owner of Supreme Energy is liable to pay that money. So those are the two important clarifications that he made. And a third one, I also asked him that there is one entity called DH Renewables which owns stake in New Power and is listed in and is a Mauritius based company. He said it's only an entity which is based in Mauritius, but it is owned by a fund, Axion Diversified Strategies Fund, which is headquartered in Singapore. So even that, it's just for tax purposes that everything is, you know, based in Singapore. But the ultimate owner of DH Renewables is Axion Diversified Strategies Fund, which is headquartered in Singapore. So those are major clarifications coming from Deepak Kochar. I did request him to speak directly on air, but his point was that there are too many agencies which are now looking at the books, and therefore it may not be proper for him to speak on his own. With that, we'll take a break and I'll be back with Anuj and Sonia, and we are into Bazaar in a minute.